Tantor Audio presents Medieval Christianity, A New History by Kevin Madigan. Narrated by Pete Larkin. Preface. By the early 7th century or so, the biblical culture today called medieval Christianity was the distinguishing and unitive religious and cultural mortar of European society. By the year 1000, 6 or 7 monarchies, countless city-states, duchies, counties, and ecclesiastical fiefdoms organized the European landmass politically and geographically. By that time, the major ethnic groups of Europe, Celtic, Germanic, Roman, and Slavic, would all be settled and Christianized. Within the midst of this considerable political, ethnic, and linguistic mix, one tradition united the continent religiously and to some extent politically, socially, and economically. Christianity. Indeed, the church was the single institution that cut across the lives, political boundaries, and ethnic divisions that otherwise made local traditions and customs so strong a factor in early medieval Europe. One can go so far as to assert, as has the great British historian R.W. Southern, that the church was identical with medieval society, and that it was this identity that distinguished it from societies that preceded and succeeded it. As Southern has also observed, the medieval church was a compulsory society in exactly the same way that the modern state is an unavoidably obligatory society. Our modern states require us to pay taxes for defense and public services, to obey their laws, and to subordinate our private desires to the good of the commonweal. Just so, baptism into medieval society required one to do all these things for the church. As Southern also observes, the medieval church was also very much like a modern state insofar as it collected taxes, administered justice in accordance with its laws, and had the power of life and death over its citizens. It had a coercive power in the Pope, coercion being expressed most usually through excommunication or the threat of it, and a purpose to its government, to direct man into a single Christian path. Only the lack of a dependable army causes the analogy to break down. The church not only formed the institutional framework within which one lived out one's life, every important event for the individual, from birth to death, including from the 9th century, marriage, was marked by ecclesiastical ritual. The same set of sacraments, set at 7 in the late 12th century, punctuated the lives of Christians in northern England and Iceland, southern Italy, western Spain and Poland. Monasteries, churches, chapels, parish churches, convents, cathedrals, and simple stone crosses covered the landscape, all professing or representing the same creed. Clergy, priests, bishops, deacons were everywhere, as were monks, nuns, and other religious. More or less the same liturgy of the Mass was celebrated in the same language across the continent. Certainly there were outsiders in this culture, principally Jewish communities and sects of heretics, but they were minorities in every sense of that modern word. This culture was held together by religious belief expressed in ancient creeds, whose authority very few challenged, or from which they dissented. Very few would have doubted the existence of a triune God who had sent his Son, both human and divine, to redeem humankind, and to set the normative and salvific pattern for human life. Nor would many have doubted that life on this earth was a journey or pilgrimage to a domain more real, more permanent, indeed eternal, to be spent in everlasting beatitude with God or never-ending punishment. A tremendous force for the unity of Christendom and for the possibility of a shared biblical culture was the possession of a common sacred language, Latin, which the Church had inherited from Rome. This was a language used in all matters of religious culture, including secular diplomacy and politics. The word secular is put in quotation marks, as medieval people did not distinguish, as we do in modern Western societies, between the sacred and the secular. Western theological literature and art are saturated in imagery and idioms taken from the Latin Bible. The Christian liturgy was conducted in Latin, as were creeds, one of the major media for instruction in the rudiments of faith in all centuries of the Middle Ages, though only clerics would have known the Latin in some times and places, as most lay Christians were not Latinate. It was also the language in schools, and eventually in universities. In his path-breaking analysis of the making of Europe in the central Middle Ages, historian Robert Bartlett has painstakingly charted the outward establishment of bishoprics, especially in the Baltic region, as Latin Europe expanded eastward and northward. He observes that in the process of expansion, new peripheries came to resemble the old center of Europe. It would not be going too far to say that something like a homogeneous culture emerged in the central Middle Ages. This culture had many shared elements, including shared military technology, agricultural practices and instruments, and the configuration of villages and towns. Yet it was a culture that also shared a common religious view of the cosmos, widespread religious beliefs, and shared religious practices. These two were essential to establishing a common European culture. It is on the establishment and evolution of this religious culture from circa 500 to 1500 that I will focus in this book. Many existing textbooks have laid out this very general picture of the Middle Ages. As is the case with most medievalists, textbooks on medieval ecclesiastical history are causing my bookshelves to groan. I have learned a vast amount from these volumes. Indeed, I owe their authors a profound debt of gratitude. The best of these textbooks are not merely works of synthesis, though synthesizing the scholarship on a millennium of history is no contemptible feat, but are also scholarly works in themselves, books that made us see the medieval church in new ways. I think, for example, of R.W. Southern's 1970 volume, Western Society and the Church in the Middle Ages. Southern's textbook brilliantly analyzed central figures, movements, and individuals, as well as relations with the Eastern Church in the High and Late Middle Ages. So, why a new textbook? My hope in composing this volume was to synthesize the important new scholarly developments in the field of medieval Christianity in the four decades since the publication of Southern's book, and to integrate them with some traditional themes and topics in medieval Christianity. I have attempted to write a narrative account of the Middle Ages, without sacrificing analytical rigor or explanatory power, one that takes advantage of the many virtues of literature published in this field since the publication of Southern's textbook. For that reason, I have spent time in almost all chapters talking about the stories of real human beings and their lives, not merely because of the intrinsic interest of their stories, but also because of the illustrative power of their lives. Listeners will notice, for example, that I have written at length on women in virtually every chapter of the book. Insofar as is possible, I have written about them in relationship not just to other women, but also to men who venerated, wrote about, sneered at, or corresponded with them. Such a book could not have been written 40 years ago. Now, a book that sidelines women to a single chapter or single section would, or in my view should, be unimaginable. All historians of medieval Christianity are deeply indebted to leading historians of women in the Middle Ages, above all to Caroline Walker Bynum, who has revolutionized our field of study. So too have scores of other scholars. This book depends heavily on their enormously stimulating contributions. Much ink has been spent since 1970 discussing popular religion and the problem of a two-tiered model of piety that attempts to explicate Christian practices in terms of the religion of the people and the religion of the prelates. While few Anglophone historians accept this historiographical model, people and prelates often participated in the same practices and murmured the same prayers, there can be little doubt that new ways of reading hagiographical sources, miracle stories, and exemplar, illustrative stories used most often in sermons, have given us new appreciation for lived religious practice, practice that oftentimes originated from below and was disciplined, chastened, approved, and very often appropriated by sources of authority from above. We now know much more about parish life and parochial Christianity, especially in the later Middle Ages, than we once did, thanks to the labors of historians like John Van Engen and Eamon Duffy. Those once regarded on the margins of medieval Christianity have also attracted increasing attention, especially since the Second Vatican Council. This is the case not only with women, but also with mystics and mysticism. One need only think of the work of Bernard McGinn to appreciate how much more we now know about these spiritual virtuosi and the literature they left than we knew in 1960. The same can be said of visionaries. Some of these, like Joachim of Fiore, were also apocalyptic thinkers and writers, as well as biblical exegetes. Here again, McGinn and others produced many studies that have advanced our understanding of this captivating field enormously. Heretics and heresy are much better understood today, and are of much more interest than they were before the Second Vatican Council, with major contributions from French, British, and American scholars. Much interest has been expressed in the way in which these and other outgroups, such as the Jewish communities of Europe, interacted with the Christian majority. In the early medieval period, these communities could and did live in something like comity in many parts of Europe. Scholars such as R.I. Moore have painted a different picture of relations among these communities at the start of the second millennium as national states emerged, and clerics, in his view, helped push such groups to the margin as Europe became, in Moore's view, a persecuting society. Contemporary history can shape scholarly agenda. Today there is great interest in interreligious relationships, hostility, and reconciliation. For that reason, and even more for reasons of deep scholarly interest, I have given significant attention to relations among Christians, Jews, and Muslims in the Middle Ages. Other scholars, such as Miri Rubin, under the influence of the cultural turn in history, have taken traditional materials, like sources on the Eucharist, and shown how they were expressed culturally and in practice. To all of this new literature, I am more indebted than I know, and more grateful than I have the words to express. I have also attempted to give listeners some taste of the major debates concerning various aspects of medieval Christianity over the past 40 years. I hope they come away with the conviction that history is an art of interpretation, and with some sense of how sources are used in debates among scholars. Occasionally, I will indicate briefly where I stand on these issues, but no student should take those verdicts as authoritative. Only deep immersion in the primary and secondary sources allows one to take such a position. These debates are perhaps useful topics for papers written in courses in which this book will be heard. My intent in this book, then, has been to produce a volume that integrates the best of traditional scholarship with the rich and important developments that have occurred in the study of medieval Christianity over the past 40 years or so. I have tried to synthesize the latest scholarship on the many cultures of conversion in the Middle Ages from Benedict in the early medieval period through the Cistercians and Mendicants in the High, and the Beguines and Observants in the later Middle Ages. I have written on some traditional topics because they would be impossible and perhaps foolish to ignore. The emergence and then centralization of papal power in the High Middle Ages, medieval religious life, heresy and its repression, and conflicts between popes and royal figures, not to mention those great monuments to the Christian Middle Ages, the university, new ways of learning, and the many movements of reform that mark the High and Late Middle Ages. As with most new textbooks, much is borrowed, if resynthesized by the author, and I again acknowledge my debts to my scholarly colleagues worldwide. Some material inevitably is old, and some should certainly be new. This, then, is a history that is at once cultural, institutional, intellectual, spiritual, and historiographical. It is also a textbook in which I accept the traditional division of the Middle Ages into three periods: early, circa 600 to 1050, high, circa 1050 to 1300, and late, circa 1300 to 1500. Above all, I have written in a prose style, and with, I hope, a narrative and intellectual depth that respects the kind of listener I have imagined to be interested in this subject matter. I have not attempted to write on every imaginable period, theme, practice, or subject of interest in this thousand-year period. Rather, I have attempted a narrative that, while selective, I aspired to make deeper and more complex than is traditional in a textbook. In addition, I have tried to respect the serious and mature listener without overwhelming the beginner, who is after all looking for an introduction to a period and to a civilization that may be in every way foreign. If there are ways I fail to achieve my aspirations and ways I can improve this book, I should be glad to hear from my listeners, care of Yale University Press, New Haven, Connecticut, zip code 06520-9040. 1. Early Christianity, circa 150 to 600. 1. Pivotal moments in early Christianity. For more than 16 centuries, historians of early Christianity, relying heavily on early Christian sources, took it as given that Orthodox Christianity, as a rule, perhaps at all times, preceded erroneous or heretical forms of Christianity. They also usually presumed that heretical sects were smaller than Orthodox groups. In his deeply learned and influential Orthodoxy and Heresy in Earliest Christianity, German historian Walter Bauer demolished that long-held premise. Over the course of the decades following his book's publication in 1934, Bauer slowly proved to the satisfaction of a vast majority of historians that in many regions of the Mediterranean, so-called heretical groups were among the earliest expressions of Christianity. As a result of Bauer's work, heresy and orthodoxy are no longer viewed by most historians in terms of secondary and primary manifestations of Christianity. In addition, many historians are reluctant to label heresy as an obvious or inevitable deviation, or to think of early or proto-orthodoxy, as I shall call the earliest forms of emerging Catholic Christianity, as self-evidently and necessarily correct. Proto-Orthodox and then early Catholic Christianity were forms of Christianity practiced in the first and second centuries. Only eventually did primitive Orthodoxy come, in part because of the dominant influence of the Roman Church, to secure the majority of practitioners describing themselves as Christians. It did so, however, largely by grappling with the doctrinal and practical challenges of the many Christian groups in the Mediterranean that came, ultimately, to be judged heretical. In so doing, and only in having to do so, did early Catholic Christianity come to define, in gradually more sophisticated and complex ways, its own understanding of the revelation handed down by the apostles. It also formed literary and institutional structures that would, it hoped, express and protect the true teaching and distinguish it for ordinary believers from the false. Nemesis, the challenge of Gnosticism. For over 16 centuries, our knowledge of Gnosticism derived almost entirely from the writings of its opponents. That changed dramatically with the discovery in 1945 of the so-called Nag Hammadi Library, or collection. It is true that 3rd and 4th century writers preserved some important texts written by Gnostics themselves, and it is also true that in the 18th century, a number of Gnostic documents in Coptic were discovered in the Egyptian desert, including the Pistis Sophia, a text purporting to be a dialogue between Christ and his apostles. Still, it remained the case for very long that our main sources for Gnosticism had been the hostile writings of Christian critics in the 2nd and 3rd centuries, writers such as Irenaeus, Clement of Alexandria, Tertullian, and Origen. Documents actually written by Gnostics were often destroyed by the Orthodox, or otherwise perished and disappeared from history. Written originally in Greek, the Nag Hammadi collection contains more than 50 texts translated into Coptic, 6 of which were already known before the discovery. The collection also contains published writings, some of which are, because of the influence of popular fiction and film, fairly well known among the public. These include the Gospel of Thomas, a collection of sayings of the risen Jesus, including some parallels to sayings in the Synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, the Gospel of Philip, which gives us a window into Gnostic ritual, and the Secret Book of John, which is illustrative of many Gnostic texts, insofar as it supplies a detailed cosmogony, or narrative, about the origins of the universe, in this case a revelation of the risen Jesus to John. This text was certainly known to hostile church fathers like Irenaeus, Published in 1977 in English in its entirety, the Nag Hammadi collection provides strong evidence of Jewish sectarian influence on Gnostic speculation, and its contents have augmented enormously our knowledge of the teaching, ritual, and purpose of Gnosticism. Among the greatest challengers to the triumph of orthodoxy were the numerous sects historians today classify, cautiously and often reluctantly, under the general rubric of Gnosticism. The word Gnosticism is an umbrella term. It is meant to describe a wide variety of religious and philosophical movements and groups in the ancient Mediterranean world. One early church father in Rome wrote a refutation of no fewer than 33 groups he considered Gnostic. Here we will concentrate on those that originated or grew in strength and numbers in the second century. We must stress that these groups regarded themselves as authentic Christians. It is important to underscore that different mythologies and rituals characterized these groups, and some scholars have gone so far as to question whether Gnosticism can even be considered a coherent category. For the purposes of this book, I will assume that the category of Gnosticism does indeed have explanatory and heuristic power, and will be stressing the commonalities among these groups. The term Gnosticism derives from the Greek word for knowledge, gnosis. Gnosticism, in most of its forms, was preoccupied with knowledge regarding the genesis of the world, the origin of evil, the destiny of the elect, and the knowledge or teaching needed to liberate one from the material domain, which it regarded as evil. The knowledge it imparted was to a small group of elect. The recipients of this revealed knowledge were a minority of humanity chosen to receive it, and destined to return to their heavenly home once liberated from ignorance of their lofty destiny. As Theodotus, a second-century Gnostic teacher and follower of Valentinus, a leading Gnostic in Rome, expressed it, "Gnosis allowed the elect to ascertain who we were and what we have become, where we were and the place to which we hurry, what truth is and what rebirth is." Usually the author of this knowledge was held to be Jesus, one of the apostles, or an enlightened teacher, who was believed to have received his knowledge via direct revelation. Gnostic salvation, therefore, was from ignorance, not from sin. That is, the fundamental problem in Gnosticism was not some inherited inclination to sin, nor the inability to do the good, nor our mortality as such. The problem was that a small group of elect were ignorant of the arcana critical to their destiny. One crucial dimension of the secret knowledge imparted to the elect involved cosmogony, or the origin of the universe, and especially the way in which the evil material realm came into existence. Most Gnostic groups believed this world to be a domain of darkness and evil, fallen by some cosmic disaster from the heavenly world of goodness. Like the beginning of the book of Genesis, many Gnostic myths focus on the story of a fall from the heavenly realm. Some of these myths depict a figure like Eve, called Wisdom, Greek Sophia, a young divine being who may have sought more than was ordained by the divine father. Again, rather like Eve in the opening chapters of Genesis. Other Gnostic myths tell of Sophia's giving birth to a dark creature with animal-like features. Like Eve after sin, this creature is ejected from the heavenly realm, called by the Gnostics the fullness, Greek pleroma. Sophia's progeny creates the world in which we live. As an unskilled or malefic being, however, he creates a world of matter. Almost all Gnostics were united in their belief that this world of matter was evil, thus disdaining the belief, common to Jews and Christians, that God had created this world and that it was good. Thus, when contemplating the material order, Gnostics, unlike later Christian defenders of orthodoxy, refused to attribute its origin to the God of goodness. Rather, it was the result of some primeval disorder, some conflict or fall, some primal glitch. As is apparent, many Gnostic myths are allegorical or symbolic readings of the Hebrew Bible, especially the book of Genesis. Indeed, some teachers of Gnosticism explained that Eve was a representation of Sophia, and that the narrative of the first chapters of Genesis illustrated the way in which she alerted Adam to the truth. In fact, many of the second century church fathers attempted to refute the Gnostics by rejecting their interpretation of Genesis. Several of the texts in the Nag Hammadi collection reflect Jewish thought about Adam and Eve. Other texts have literary parallels in Jewish apocryphal literature. In short, the evidence suggests that much of Gnostic mythology originated in heterodox Jewish circles, though scholars have not been able to identify who precisely belonged to these groups. More clear is that many Gnostic Christian teachers were active in Alexandria, which had a large and educated Jewish community. Strong links existed between Judaism and Christianity in Alexandria. Some early Christian teachers, like Valentinus, perhaps traveling the grain road between Egypt and Rome, eventually made their way to the capital city of the Roman Empire. At first a member of the primitive Orthodox community there, Valentinus eventually became an influential Gnostic teacher and prolific author. In any case, most Christian Gnostic teachers claim to have understood the true revelation of Jesus Christ and to have preserved the secret tradition passed down by the apostles. The knowledge so acquired and preserved was not gained by study, but by revelation of secret knowledge. This was true even though the Gnostics knew and read the Gospels, as well as the letters of Paul, who deeply influenced their understanding of Gnosis. Yet the Gnostics were convinced that they had achieved deeper insight into the Scriptures than was available to simple, uneducated Christians. See 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 and 7. The Gnostics, to employ a biblical metaphor, consumed solid food, while ordinary immature Christians drank the milk of simple teaching. See the 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 2 through 4. For the Gnostics, the Scriptures expressed far more than what was given in the literal, plain sense of the text. Actually, the Gnostics were among the first Christians to read into the Scriptures a second, higher, or allegorical meaning. For the Gnostic, the true meaning of the text was deeply hidden. It needed to be excavated in light of the gnosis that had been given the reader. It should be noted that here the Gnostics shared much, interpretively or hermeneutically, with their proto-Orthodox and Orthodox counterparts. This advanced doctrine was expressed in much Gnostic writing in intentionally mysterious language, so much so that it is extremely difficult, even for trained scholars today, to interpret these documents. In any case, the revelation supplied by the Scriptures was, again, the knowledge that the Gnostic reader was a spirit trapped in flesh. Many Gnostics also believed that in the primal fall, a spark of the spiritual or divine had entered into the bodies of some human beings. Consequently, the soteriological or salvific aim of Gnosticism was to receive the knowledge that enabled the practitioner to escape this evil material domain and to return to the heavenly realm, how they had found themselves in their present plight, to reveal to them that they were elected for a grand destiny, and to furnish them with the knowledge allowing them to be restored to their heavenly home. Those Christian Gnostics who believed Christ to have been the revealer of saving Gnosis were distinguished from their Orthodox counterparts because they presumed that no divine emissary could have assumed human flesh. Indeed, he only appeared in human form. Technically, this strain of Christology is called docetic. It derives from the Greek verb for to seem, to appear, and is characterized by its central conviction that the spirit Jesus only seemed to be human. Perhaps a spirit temporarily inhabited the human being Jesus, or he assumed a phantasmal human appearance. This was a critical point of disagreement between the proto-Orthodox and the Gnostics, because it centered on the issue of soteriology, or the doctrine of salvation. In the view of Gnosticism's critics, if the incarnate Word had not assumed real human flesh, humanity was doomed. What was not assumed or taken on by Christ in their eyes could not be saved by him. Had Christ not taken on human flesh, then humanity could not have been redeemed, elevated, transformed. For the Gnostics, it was self-evident that humanity and divinity could not be united, and therefore that Christ did not experience any ordinary physical or psychological passion or infirmity. Instead, he only appeared to suffer on the cross, to die, and to rise from the dead. Rather, his heavenly soul left his quasi-human clothing at the time of the crucifixion. Teachings such as these genuinely alarmed proto-Orthodox and Orthodox teachers in the 2nd and early 3rd centuries. They soon would devise ways of sharply distinguishing themselves and their beliefs from those of their heretical archenemies. Marcion and Marcionism. A teacher who shared much with Gnosticism, and indeed was counted among the Gnostics by Irenaeus, like belief in the inferiority and incompetence of the Creator God, was Marcion of Pontus. He was among the very most influential heretical teachers of the second century. His teaching, and the many new churches he created, put new questions to the emerging Orthodox Church, as challenging as those of the Gnostic teachers. Ultimately, most of the Church Fathers already mentioned, though most did not regard him as a Gnostic, felt compelled to respond to him vigorously. Born in Sinope, a port city in the province of Pontus on the Black Sea, Marcion was the son of a bishop in that city. A wealthy shipowner and merchant, he traveled to Rome around 140 and joined the Christian community there, to which he donated a large sum of money. Having soon fallen under the influence of a Gnostic teacher named Cerdo, he began to develop his own theological ideas, which he then proceeded to explain to the leaders of the Roman Church. Horrified, the leaders returned his money and then in July 144 excommunicated him. Undaunted and bent on spreading his teachings, Marcion founded his own church. It had a ritual and organization so similar to those of the Roman Church that contemporary Orthodox Christians felt compelled to warn their flocks not to enter a Marcionite church by accident. One contemporary Christian, Justin Martyr, asserts that Marcion's ideas were so rapidly and widely disseminated that they could be found everywhere in the Roman Empire by the middle of the second century. Wholly characteristic of Marcion and his followers was the great ontological gulf they posited in the divine realm. Marcionites tended to view theological ideas in binary, dichotomous ways. Thus, they separated an inferior creator god, or demiurge, the god of the Hebrew Bible, from the sovereign god of the New Testament. So far as sacred literature went, Marcion distinguished sharply between the Old and New Testaments, the former of which Marcion identified with law, and the latter as gospel. According to Marcion, the creator God was thoroughly inferior. The creator of Adam, he had permitted evil into the world. Ignorant of Adam's whereabouts, he had to call out to find him. Every act of the creator God had its opposite or antinomy in a parallel act of goodness carried out by the Christian God. These antinomies Marcion laid out in detail in a book he entitled, appropriately enough, Antitheses. If the Jewish God taught an eye-for-an-eye ethic, then, Marcion pointed out, Christ had urged his followers to love one's enemies. Only the God of Jesus Christ, as revealed in the New Testament, deserved the name of God. Like the Gnostics, Marcionites were docetic in their Christology. Based on his assumption that matter was irredeemably evil, Marcion rejected the notion that Christ assumed a material body in the Incarnation. Nor could he accept the orthodox assertion that Christ had been born of a woman. These central and non-negotiable elements of the emerging Christian creed, challenged by Marcion so bluntly, would induce the orthodox to fashion fuller and more complex creeds by the end of the century. Marcion's view on the sacred scriptures of Judaism and Christianity were, with respect to the evolving orthodox perspective, quite radical. Unlike most church fathers who read the Hebrew Bible typologically or Christologically, that is, as consisting of many prophecies of a suffering Messiah, Marcion read the text quite literally, and he rejected the allegorical method of interpretation, here distinguishing himself hermeneutically from the Gnostics. He appreciated the Old Testament only as a historical document of the evolution of Jewish religion, and because it bore an important ethical code. Even this he believed to have been abrogated at the beginning of the Christian era. Marcion had an equally idiosyncratic view of the New Testament, persuaded that Paul alone had correctly interpreted the revelation of Jesus' teachings. He rejected the apostles as Judaizers, who simply taught another form of Judaism. On the basis of Galatians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, Marcion concluded that there could be only one gospel, in his view, Luke, whom he identified as a companion of Paul. Even still, both the letters of Paul and the Gospel of Luke had also been perverted by Jewish or Judaizing influence. Thus, any element of Paul that harkened back appreciatively to the Hebrew Bible or elements of Luke, like the genealogy and infancy narratives, had to be purged. Marcion's significance, then, is that he seems to have been the first to compile a list of authoritative Christian writings. His canon contained one gospel, namely an expurgated version of Luke, and 10 edited letters of Paul. Any part of the Pauline letters that harkened back to the Old Testament, Marcion rejected as Judaizing interpolations. He simply purged these. Marcion's canon encouraged Christians to begin to re-examine their own assumptions about the relationship between the two biblical testaments and stimulated them to begin to compile their own list of authoritative writings, or canon. Montanus and Montanism. Another group that antagonized groups of emerging Catholic Christians was an ecstatic and prophetic movement known as Montanism, after its first founder, Montanus. Emerging first in the late 2nd and 3rd centuries, it originated in Phrygia in Asia Minor, and was thus sometimes known by contemporaries as the Phrygian heresy. One interesting question having to do with geographical origins is, why Asia Minor? The most plausible explanation is that the Gospel of John, the one gospel in which Jesus proclaims the coming of a comforter or paraclete, often identified as an inspiring spirit, was very popular in Asia Minor. Asia Minor was also the setting for the composition of the Apocalypse, or the Book of Revelation, which is filled with visions and prophecies. Not surprisingly, adherents claim to have received direct ecstatic revelations from God, many of them eschatological, or more precisely millennial, as most followers of Montanus believed, with local chauvinism, that the thousand-year kingdom promised in Apocalypse chapter 12 would soon descend in Phrygia. Among the more interesting elements of this prophetic group is that without question it had women prophetic leaders, and Montanus is mentioned in the sources, primarily the Ecclesiastical History, Book 5, Chapter 16, verses 13 and 17, of the great early Christian historian Eusebius of Caesarea, with the two most famous of them, Priscilla and Maximilla. All the prophets maintained strict practices of ascetical discipline, eating little, observing hours of fasting, and abstaining from marriage and sex. It is quite clear that the Montanists were not doctrinally deviant in the way, say, that contemporary Gnostic groups were. What made them dangerous in the eyes of many leaders in the Asian, and by 177, the Roman churches, was the very claim of experiencing new revelation outside the emerging channels of early normative Christianity. A series of synods was held in Asia Minor, the first in Christian history, and the result was that the Montanists, again according to Eusebius, Ecclesiastical History 5:16-16, were excommunicated. Then in 177, the Montanists were excommunicated by the Bishop of Rome. Why? Again, they were not heterodox, and they practiced an admirably strict lifestyle. The issue was whether there could be prophecy or new revelation after the age of the apostles, and if so, could women be vehicles of it? Ultimately, bishops felt that prophets were too great a threat to their own precariously established authority. One group of bishops was so opposed to women prophets that it attempted to exorcise Maximilla. This was not before Montanism had captured its prize convert, Tertullian. In the end, it was concluded that the Age of Revelation had ended. We might say also that the Age of the History of Exegesis had begun. In addition, the controversy stimulated the development of a new important structure in the history of normative Christianity, the Synod or Council. This was to become the preferred way to settle disputes regarding belief and discipline for two millennia in the history of Christianity. Almost needless to say, Orthodox Christians reacted strongly to Gnostic teaching. They criticized the multitude of Gnostic sects and warned that heterodox Gnostics could easily appear to be Orthodox Christians. For their part, most Gnostics thought Orthodox Christians were stupefied by their captivity to matter. This prevented them from perceiving the truth. For example, while Orthodox Christians believed in the resurrection of the material body, Gnostics scoffed. Resurrection actually referred to the union of the disembodied souls with their Savior. Again, Orthodox Christians believed that the crucifixion of Jesus atoned for sin. Gnostics argued that, to the contrary, such thinking was absurd. No heavenly being could possibly have died on the cross. In fact, the heavenly revealer had come in a material body that served simply as a vehicle during his earthly life, much as a spacesuit allows an astronaut to function in outer space. Gnostics found hidden meanings in the scriptures and derided Christians for reading Jesus' sayings and interpreting his actions in a plain literal sense. Simple Christians concentrated on the earthly life of Jesus and lived in ignorance of the revelations that the resurrected Jesus gave to the disciples. While Orthodox Christians believed in a judgment at the end of time, Gnostics thought it occurred at death, when the individual's soul left the body. For them, the end of the world referred only to the disintegration of the dark material world, when all light would return to the heavenly world. Christian intellectuals retaliated, essentially by affirming points denied by the Gnostics and denying affirmations they proclaimed. Unlike the Gnostics, Christians identified and worshipped the God of Judaism and retained its scriptures as their own. It was that God who had created the world, who had made it good, and who would resurrect his faithful at the end of ages. The Father of Jesus Christ and the God of the Hebrew Bible were, in their view, one and the same God. Christian intellectuals emphatically rejected the docetic understanding of Christ, according to which Christ came to the world in the angelic or phantasmagoric body. They insisted, to the contrary, that Christ assumed true human flesh, that he experienced the full spectrum of emotional and physical passions, and above all, that he suffered and died on the cross. This insistence has its roots in soteriology. Christian intellectuals asserted strongly that salvation depended on Jesus of Nazareth, the incarnate Word, having taken on a human body. Only that which is assumed could be saved, they insisted. Redemption could not have occurred if Jesus had not taken on human flesh. The emergence of normative Christianity, creed, council, clergy. It has been recognized that Christians formed three structures to express and guard the truth of early Catholic Christianity: creeds, or rules of faith, as they were initially called, canons of scripture, and authoritative clergy, especially the single bishop, slowly recognized as the authoritative teacher in the community. One of the most effective instruments devised by the proto-Orthodox against the hodgepodge of non-normative Christianities was the creation of laconic or compact creeds. Few structures of early Orthodox Christianity demonstrate as clearly as these primitive rules of faith that early Catholic faith and thought were shaped in the matrix of rivalry with ecclesiastical antagonists, above all the many Gnostic groups in the empire. Some of the earliest rules of faith and some of the Church's enduring creedal language were first expressed in occasional letters written by proto-Orthodox Christians. The example par excellence of this is the letters of Ignatius of Antioch. While being transported from his see in Syria to Rome for execution, Ignatius, once Bishop of Antioch, wrote six letters to communities in Asia Minor. In these letters, he warned the proto-Orthodox to beware of those who spread false teaching. He meant Gnostic teachers, or groups who doubted the actuality of Christ's human flesh, particularly those who denied the true physicality of the incarnate Christ, or the reality of his suffering, death, and physical resurrection. The language and categories he uses anticipate in content, and in some cases verbally, those used in the first Catholic creeds at the end of the second century. Consider, for example, his letter to the community of Smyrna, written in the first decade of the second century. In that epistle, he proclaims Christ to have been descended from David in the flesh. He asserts that he was truly born of a woman, and that truly he perished on a cross. And he says very similar things in his other letters. Each of the clauses in his letter to Smyrna can be understood as having been aimed at a disputed tenet of Gnostic belief. Each was intended to repudiate the Gnostic understanding of Christ's flesh and to promote that of the proto-Orthodox, asserting that Jesus had truly suffered so that we might gain salvation. Ignatius yokes the budding doctrine of the Incarnation, namely that the Word had taken flesh, with the proto-Orthodox primitive teaching regarding salvation, and he emphasizes the actuality of Jesus' physical being by repetition of the word truly, an adverb that would be appropriated regularly in later Christian creeds. Derived from the Latin word for I believe, credo, creeds are more formal, often short, official, and authorized statements of the essential elements of Christian belief. As already suggested, many early Christian creeds drew liberally on existing pre-creedal language, like the confessional letters of Ignatius. Such creeds were usually fixed in wording. Ritually speaking, they were by the mid-second century associated with baptism. Indeed, catechumens memorized and recited them publicly before baptism. From a theological and structural point of view, creeds eventually took on a Trinitarian form, though the heart of the earliest creeds was a series of Christological confessions. One of the earliest and best known of these is the so-called Old Roman Creed, probably composed around 180. I believe in God the Father Almighty, and in Christ Jesus, his only Son, our Lord, who was born from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, who, under Pontius Pilate, was crucified and buried, on the third day rose again from the dead, ascended to heaven, sits at the right hand of the Father, whence he will come to judge the living and the dead, and in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church, the remission of sins, the resurrection of the flesh. The function of a creed, some of the clauses of which rhymed in Latin and were thus easily memorized, like this, was to give simple believers a touchstone by which to distinguish the Orthodox faith from the many varieties of heterodox Christianity to which they might otherwise have been vulnerable. It was intended to allow them to distinguish the slowly emerging proto-Orthodox consensus from Gnostic and Marcionite views, especially regarding the nature of Christ. It was on this old Roman creed that many later Western creeds verbally and theologically depended, and that later Christians embellished as they gave more metaphysical and linguistic precision to their understanding of God, the Son, and the relationship between them. A second structure built to ground the faith of early Catholic Christianity was the formation of the New Testament canon. For the first century and a half of the Christian era, the term New Testament was not used. For the earliest Christians, the scriptures were the writings of the Septuagint, the version of the Hebrew Bible translated into Greek. Over the course of the 160 or so years from the death of Jesus of Nazareth, all sorts of written literature about him, his teachings, and his life and death had been produced: gospels, letters, apocalypses, sermons, and treatises. Almost all of these were written pseudonymously, that is, under the name of an apostle or group of apostles. Many of these were of Gnostic or Marcionite origin. Accordingly, early Orthodox Christians began to draw up lists of writings believed to be inspired by the Holy Spirit, and so to have the same authority as the Septuagint. We do not know exactly how this canon was formed. It was surely important that the gospel be widely read in liturgy and attached to an apostolic name. But since so many claimed to be of apostolic origin, it seems that conformity with what was taught in the rules of faith and creed turned out to be a decisive criterion. We assume that bishops of communities played an important role in distinguishing true from false writings. What is not in doubt is that by roughly the end of the second century, evidence suggests that early Catholics had adopted a canon very much like modern authoritative canons, even if some of the lists that exist contain or omit books not finally recognized as authoritative. For example, a fragment from about 200 CE, probably written in Rome and known as the Muratorian Fragment after the scholar who, leafing through a volume in the Vatican Library, discovered it, knew the same four Gospels as we, 13 letters of Paul, and two he claims were pseudo-Pauline, the letter of Jude, two of John's letters, and the Apocalypse. In short, he knew 22 of the 27 documents that were finally included in the authoritative versions of the New Testament. By 367, a canon produced by Athanasius, Bishop of Alexandria, that is identical to the New Testament canon as known today, existed. Still, the point to stress is that by roughly 200 CE, early Orthodox Christian communities had established a list of authoritative writings and distinguished them from heterodox writings they had not accepted. Again, this was a crucial development in the emergence of normative Christianity, stimulated by the thought of heterodox thinkers, in this case Marcion above all. So too was the development of the monarchical episcopate. Evidence from the 2nd century suggests that a wide variety of models for local clergy existed throughout the Roman Empire, yet the one to prevail was a three-tiered hierarchical model. In this model, the bishop served as leader of the local community and was assisted by presbyters or priests, elders, and deacons. Again, this model was established in the Antioch of Ignatius, as he underscores emphatically the necessity of gathering for learning, ritual, and teaching around a single bishop. By the end of the century, this three-tiered form of ministry had spread to most early Catholic communities throughout the empire, and it would soon become the sole authoritative manner of organizing local ecclesiastical communities. Arguing against the Gnostic idea that revelation was secret knowledge passed down by charismatic teachers, the Proto-Orthodox argued that, to the contrary, it had been transmitted by the apostles to their successors, duly appointed bishops. Some local communities in the late 2nd century drew lines of succession from contemporary bishops back to the community's founding teacher, often but not always an apostle, in order to demonstrate that the teaching of the local community was true and authoritative. Technically, this idea is called the doctrine of apostolic succession. It was also stressed that the oldest apostolic churches, Rome and other churches mentioned in the New Testament especially, were sure havens of authoritative teaching. The consistency in the teaching of living bishops with one another was also stressed as proof of apostolic origin, this in contrast to the multifarious quality of Gnostic teaching. Irenaeus, for example, worked his way back from Eleutherus all the way to the apostles Peter and Paul as commonly regarded founders of the Roman Church, which he recognized as having special authority in doctrinal matters. He did the same for Smyrna, the town where he had grown up, claiming that Bishop Polycarp, who had been martyred in 155, had been appointed by the apostles. Again, the public succession of bishops from the apostles was, however tenuous historically speaking, used to fortify the conviction that a local bishop was a living witness to and bearer of the authority of the apostles in matters of revelation. Slowly, the many forms of Christian authority, such as prophets, apostles, and teachers, gave way to the authority in each community of a single or monarchical bishop. Through the establishment of creed, canon, and clergy, early Catholic Christianity was moving to take the shape it would assume for centuries to come. The challenge of Gnosticism had been met. At the same time, Christians were facing questions, trials, and occasionally tyranny from the Roman state. The Roman State and Persecution. Enthusiasts of the films of Cecil B. DeMille and of historical fiction may be pardoned for imagining that early Christians were unremittingly persecuted by the Roman state, indeed that the emperor himself issued imperial dictates that outlawed the young religion, that a vast multitude of Christians died at the hands of intolerant Romans, consumed by lions in the imperial Colosseum, and that Christians had to be on guard against the ceaseless, ubiquitous threat of Roman persecution. In fact, until the mid-3rd century, Christians were only sporadically persecuted. There was no Roman law specifically outlawing the practice of Christianity, though laws against unauthorized societies could have been applied to Christian assemblies. Persecution was local, usually mob-driven, or instigated by a magistrate under pressure from an inflamed local populace. Finally, it was often fleeting, and, while often horrible, neither injurious nor mortal for most. Nor was it an impediment to the numerical or geographical growth of the Christian church. Indeed, until 250 or so, there are 40-year periods for which there is simply no evidence anywhere in the empire of Christians suffering at Roman hands simply for being Christian. In the end, Christians would survive persecution even when it turned ruthless. Then, the most serious problem bequeathed to the Christian church, one that would plague it for over a century, was essentially a theological one. How, if at all, to reconcile and reintegrate into the community those who had seriously sinned by apostatizing during the persecution? Why were Christians persecuted at all? Far from intolerant toward other religions, the Romans were notably pluralistic and inclusive. Even when conquering other territories, the Romans brought back to the empire the gods of subjugated peoples. Indeed, the Romans worshipped the gods promiscuously, convinced that their military and political success depended on the support of as many gods as achievable. It is no accident that one of the most recognizable of all ancient temples in Rome is the Pantheon, dedicated, as its very name suggests, to all the gods. Only cults that seemed to encourage immorality or sedition fell under suspicion. Yet it was precisely on these grounds that Christian communities came to be oppressed, first by local mobs and magistrates. Christians were suspected by their Roman neighbors of malfeasance, of which they were surely innocent. What did not cause hostility was Christian propensity to win converts or proclaim in public. In fact, there is very little evidence that in the second century Christians actively proselytized. On the other hand, clandestine religious practice and detachment from society, Christians by and large avoided the public baths that ubiquitously served as hubs of social life, intellectual activity, and even politics, were habits about which the Romans harbored reservations and suspicion. Christian cultic and theological language made neighbors believe Christians to be immoral and ghoulish. Thus, language about the consumption of flesh and blood sounded to Roman ears, understandably enough, rather like cannibalism. Just so, discourse about love of brother and sister appeared to suggest the practice of incest. Refusal to participate in the military, at least in the first 3 centuries of the new religion's existence, because participation demanded official sacrifices and the kind of civil religion familiar to Americans and British today, irritated as well. Beyond that, Christians were mistrusted for supposedly meeting secretly and for being antisocial and taciturn. This caused the Romans to charge them with misanthropy or hatred of the human race. Some Christian wives left their non-Christian husbands for a life of devotion or martyrdom. Perhaps most galling was their rigorous exclusivity, devotion to the God of Jesus Christ, and stubborn refusal to participate in the cult of dead and living emperors. Also unbearable was the Christian conviction that all other cults were demonic in inspiration. This notion that all other cults were demonic is the origin of the curious charge that the Christians were atheists. Their contempt for pagan ritual, Western Christians coined the term pagan, to mean something like rubes who continued to practice traditional cults, and their religious exclusivity struck some as insufferable arrogance. Provincial governors who commanded Christians to worship the Roman gods were probably infuriated by nothing so much as their refusal to do so. For this obstinate refusal, we know some, like Pliny, the Roman governor of Bithynia Pontus, a province on the Black Sea, tortured and executed a number of Christians around 112. Here it is important to recall that the Romans connected public worship of the gods with prosperity, or at least immunity from natural, economic, or political disasters. Finally, the Roman government and some of the populace were deeply suspicious of secret societies or political associations, heteriae, and some probably saw Christian assemblies in the categories of these outlawed groups. Others probably perceived them, more accurately, as a kind of burial society. In light of this view of Christians, it cannot be surprising that suspicious and hostile Romans blamed and occasionally persecuted them, especially in times of adversity. Tertullian famously observed that the Romans think the Christians to be the cause of every public disaster, of every affliction with which the people are visited. If the Tiber rises as high as the city walls, if the Nile does not send its waters up over the fields, if the heavens give no rains, if there is an earthquake, if there is famine or pestilence, immediately the cry is, "Away with the Christians to the lions!" The aforementioned Pliny persecuted local Christians in Bithynia Pontus because of local economic factors. Similarly, regional factors unknown to us caused mob violence in Gaul in 177. Some Christians were brutally tortured, others tormented by animals in the amphitheater. Still others lapsed, and as the Romans ordered, worshipped the gods. In the end, the bodies of the martyrs were torn to pieces and deposited in the Rhone River, probably to discourage belief in their resurrection, as well as to prevent the recovery of the bodies for burial and the formation of martyrs' shrines. In the case of the persecution in Gaul, the names of 10 martyrs, witnesses, in these cases blood witnesses, survive, though perhaps 4 or 5 times that many died before, within a year or so, the persecution mysteriously stopped, and the Christian communities in Lyon and Vienne survived. Martyrs were the first Christians recognized as saints by the early Christian community. They had died an agonizing death rather than deny their Savior. In so dying, they had imitated, as nearly as possible, the violent death of their Lord. Their deaths not only proved to be a powerful and in some cases nearly irresistible model to Christians themselves, they seem to have impressed at least some Romans as well. Theologically, it was understood that martyrdom was a sign of election by God. The martyr's sin was forgiven, and he was given the gift of a martyr's crown, assurance of eternal life. Practically, martyrdom was socially flattening, opening the real possibility of a saving death to slaves and free, as well as to women, none more illustrious than the North African aristocrat Perpetua, who has left us with an account of her time awaiting persecution. Perpetua's account consists of her prison diaries while awaiting martyrdom. Thematically, they focus upon her father's attempt to persuade his daughter to recant, and thus to save herself. Some of the most poignant passages in the diaries have to do with Perpetua's struggles to overcome her maternal attachment to her newly born son. Eventually, she hands over her son to be brought up by her father. Her diaries are punctuated by 4 visions. One assures her that her prayers have delivered her brother from post-mortem suffering. The second and third are related to her own martyrdom, in one of which she says she became a man in the arena. In the fourth vision, Perpetua's slave, Felicitas, bears a daughter in prison. Her baby girl is given over to a Christian woman to raise. The visions likely indicate at least that the editor of Perpetua's account was a Montanist, as he is persuaded that her visions are as authentic as any in the New Testament. Along with a handful of other catechumens, for the persecution was launched against catechumens, not those already baptized, Perpetua and Felicitas were torn apart in an agonizing battle against the wild animals in the Colosseum at Carthage. Their saintly fate was already sealed when the 5th century North African bishop, Augustine of Hippo, preached 4 sermons on Perpetua's faith and heroic character. This kind of example of supreme faith in the face of harassment and awful persecution shaped Christian practice and its primitive literature. Very early evidence suggests other Christians wished to be buried near the tombs of the saints so that they might be taken up in their power on the day of resurrection. These tombs also became pilgrimage sites. Some of our earliest datable Christian documents in the West are accounts of martyrdom. These helped fix the martyr as the supreme example of devotion and holiness in the early church. Even when the age of martyrdom ended, the church sought to keep continuity with the Church of the Martyrs by filling its calendar with feast days, commemorating the saints who had given all for their faith. When monks succeeded martyrs as the highest exemplars of Christian life, they imagined themselves as latter-day martyrs, living out a sort of slow-motion martyrdom of bodily mortification and sacrifice on a daily basis. The martyr, given new contours and dimensions over the ages, would remain an ideal for Christians for centuries. The chance to become a martyr increased dramatically in the second half of the 3rd century. Until then, persecution had largely been sporadic, local, and unsystematic. No state-sponsored persecution occurred, nor were there attempts to exterminate the Christian population, nor even in any organized way to curb the growth of catechumens. In the mid-3rd century, much of this changed. Why then? Beginning as early as the late 2nd century and intensifying in the 3rd, the Roman Empire was plagued by political instability, war, inflation, famine, infectious disease, and population decline. As Rome's political and economic success had long been linked to the favor of the gods, many Romans could only conclude that their empire's dissolution was connected to the anger of the gods. Accordingly, near the millennial anniversary of Rome's founding, the Emperor Decius issued an edict requiring a general sacrifice to the gods. This took the Christian church by surprise. Some Christians flocked to the temples to do worship to the Roman gods. Others held fast. Fabian, Bishop of Rome, was executed, as were the bishops of Antioch and Jerusalem. It was at this time that the great theologian Origen was tortured. Other bishops, like Cyprian of Carthage, fled persecution and disappeared. Many Christians, including some bishops, like the Spanish bishops Martialis and Basilides, purchased certificates verifying that they had performed the sacrifice. In the end, perhaps hundreds of Christians died. But many more had lapsed, offering sacrifice to the gods. The question of their readmission or reconciliation to the church, even whether such reconciliation was possible, would dominate much theological debate about sin and penance for the next two centuries. It would also split the North African church for centuries. After another brief persecution by the Emperor Valerian, the church enjoyed for the second time in the 3rd century a 40-year period in which it was not terrorized by persecution, with the exception of a single Christian soldier who, when promoted, refused to sacrifice. The Emperor Gallienus issued a decree that might be considered the first decree of toleration in Christian history. Returning confiscated property to the bishops, he allowed them for the first time officially to continue their episcopal duties. These 40 years were decades in which Christians and their increasingly prominent buildings grew in numbers and visibility. By the dawn of the 4th century, some towns in the eastern part of the empire and some in North Africa likely had Christian majorities. Among these were at least some intellectuals and aristocrats. These 40 years of peace were to be dramatically interrupted during the reign of Diocletian. Known for his administrative skill, Diocletian divided the empire bureaucratically into west and east, with an emperor, or Augustus, and vice-emperor, Caesar, for each vast region. It was he who launched the fiercest, longest, and most systematic purge of the Christians, traditionally called the Great Persecution. Persuaded that the Christians were the cause of bad omens, and also to blame for a deteriorating economy, the emperor issued a series of edicts that ordered, first, that all palace and military personnel sacrifice to the gods as a test of their loyalty. He then decided to terminate the Christian community for its refusal to participate. In November 303, Roman soldiers destroyed and looted a church in Nicomedia and burned its holy books. Soon an edict was published, requiring the destruction of all churches and sacred scriptures. In response, Christians in the east revolted and burned some imperial buildings. Diocletian retaliated by burning almost 300 Christians in Nicomedia. Another edict was issued. All higher clergy were to be imprisoned, but a third edict allowed them reprieve, on the condition that they would sacrifice. A fourth edict raised the stakes by requiring all to sacrifice. The penalty was hard labor or death. This time, thousands, not hundreds, were tortured, mutilated, enslaved, incarcerated, or put to death. In the end, the persecution failed. By the 4th century, many Christians had non-Christian friends or relatives who were disgusted by their torture or death. Western officials were notably reluctant to carry out the harsh decrees mandating death, willing only to comply with the edicts demanding the burning of scriptures. In the East, suffering was more severe. We have the names of about 100 martyrs who died in Palestine alone. There must have been more. Still, the Roman state could not carry out a mass extermination of Christians, as there was far too much social resistance. In addition, the numbers of Christians had grown to the point where attempted liquidation would have been futile. Diocletian finally retired in 305. Soon, the son of a Roman emperor, Constantine, who was sympathetic to the Christians, emerged on the scene. According to several accounts, Constantine and possibly his army had dreams and visions in which he was ordered to impose the Chi Rho sign, the first two Greek letters for the name Christ, on the shield of his soldiers. He did, and in 312 he defeated his main rival for the imperial throne in the west, Maxentius, who ruled Italy and North Africa while Constantine had taken Gaul, Britain and Spain at the famous Battle of the Milvian Bridge in Rome. The first blush of a new morning for the Christians was visible, this time from the west. Constantine. Not only was Christianity tolerated by Constantine, but the new emperor would also shower the church with gifts, buildings, and money. He built grand churches at the sacred loci of Christianity, including churches celebrating Christ's birth, baptism and resurrection, and Peter's death in Rome. Eusebius of Caesarea reports in a document whose complete authenticity is doubtful that Constantine even gave directions about how lavishly he wanted churches to be appointed. Constantine's successors would continue this pattern. Many churches would become quite wealthy. Their clergy were exempt from taxation and other onerous obligations like labor. Although not baptized until near death, not uncommon at the time, Constantine was regarded so highly that contemporary Christian intellectuals considered him a virtual savior, designating him a friend of the Logos and a 13th apostle. After establishing a new capital in Byzantium, which the new emperor renamed Constantinople, today known as Istanbul, Constantine died in 337. Roughly 40 years later, one of his successors, Theodosius, made Christianity the legal or official religion of the empire. Within a half century, the Christian community had raised from a position of abomination and persecution to one of imperial privilege and munificence. The tables turned. Paganism, along with deviant forms of Christianity, would now be legally forbidden, though this hardly brought an end to pagan practice. At the beginning of the second century, the Christian community was perhaps 0.1% of an imperial population of maybe 60 million. By the time of Constantine, it constituted perhaps 10% of the population, with higher numbers in the east than the west. Now the number of converts began to soar. By the 380s, it may well have made up the majority of the imperial population. The churches organized themselves along the lines laid down by the geography and political order of the empire. A city, civitas, along with its surrounding rural perimeter, the foundation of imperial organization, also formed the basic unit of ecclesiastical structure. Virtually every Roman city, many of them quite small, had its own bishop. He exercised his authority over a diocese that ordinarily coincided with the boundaries of the civitas. These dioceses were then grouped into provinces, over which a metropolitan, the bishop of a province's principal city, held sway. Eventually, provinces themselves were organized into large patriarchates, each led by one of the five preeminent bishops of the church, those in Rome, Constantinople, called New Rome, second in prestige to the old, Antioch, Alexandria, and Jerusalem. These bishops set an important precedent by meeting in local councils to discuss and rule on matters of doctrine and discipline. Some of their decisions, recorded often in letters, became the foundation of another key element in Christianity, canon law. The first large council of hundreds of bishops met in Nicaea in 325. It was called by none other than Constantine. This was another crucial precedent. The first seven ecumenical, worldwide in theory but not in fact, councils were gathered by the Roman or later Byzantine emperors. What they and Constantine first of all were to discover was that they could not contain the theological quarrels to which the church's priests and bishops were prone, this despite the fact that they were the acknowledged heads of the Eastern churches. These quarrels quite naturally centered on the nature of Christ, his relationship to God the Father, and the way in which humanity and divinity could coexist in a single human being, who was also the incarnate deity. For example, the council at Nicaea was summoned because of a view of the relationship of the Father and the Son called Arianism, after its founding teacher, the Alexandrian priest Arius. The literary result of the council was the Nicene Creed, later amended at the Second Ecumenical Council in Constantinople. It is still regarded as authoritative by Christians today. The bishops at the council concluded that the Father and Son were made of the same essence or substance, ousia, yet they could not prevent those who supported Arius's view, which imagined the Son to be a creature far inferior to the Father, from continuing to promulgate their views. Indeed, the Arians clung to their teaching ferociously, as would several emperors in the 4th century. For our purposes, Arius and his teachings are important as varieties of Neo-Arianism sprung up, or were thought by observers to have done so, throughout the history of Christianity, including the Middle Ages. They would attract the attention of Orthodox clergy and face the same fate as Arius, whom the Nicene Council condemned and anathematized. Just as Nicaea failed to establish the Christian doctrine of God to everyone's satisfaction, so another notable council, this one in Chalcedon, again called by the emperor, failed to solve the knotty problem of how a truly divine and truly human nature could come together and unite in the single person of Jesus Christ, the incarnate Word of God. Again, a creed was issued. It simply declared that Christ was truly divine and truly human, and that these natures had come together to form a single, integrated person. The creed succeeded in persuading some churches, like the Catholic in the West, while reinforcing theological divisions it had been called to heal in the East. The result, especially in the East, was a fracturing of the unity of the churches along dogmatic lines, divisions that defined the churches for centuries and to the present day. As the Constantinian era wore on, some Christians began to feel their religion was losing the rigor required of the baptized during the times of persecution. They swarmed to the desert and established one of the institutions that would come to define medieval Christianity, monasticism. As medieval Christianity depended heavily, socially, intellectually, economically, in terms of religious influence and in many other ways to be discussed, on the institution of monasticism and on monks, it is important to understand the emergence of this form of life in the deserts of Egypt, Syria, and Judea. As more serious Christians began to believe, not wrongly, that the skyrocketing numbers of converts were merely nominal or tepid believers, they began to move into the remote deserts, where they could dedicate themselves to a life of profound Christian commitment, asceticism and prayer, bodily self-mortification, and rumination on the scriptures. Some adopted an eremitical or hermit style of life, of which St. Anthony was the illustrious exemplar. Others followed a cenobitical or communal form of life, the form that would come to dominate in the West. Women as well as men, who far outnumbered the women, felt this call to the desert, and monastic establishments were built for them in the wild places. By the end of the 4th century, thousands of monks were living in the desert, making, in the words of Antony's biographer Athanasius, the desert a city. The story of the transmission of this way of life to the West is a complex one. Part of the story is the enormous influence of the Latin translation of Athanasius's Life of St. Antony. A crucial development for the future unity of the Church was that monks were often chosen to be bishops, a pattern exemplified by Martin of Tours, died 397, who established the first monastery in Gaul, then, after his election as bishop in circa 372, continued to lead a monastic life. Among those nudged to convert by the influence of Athanasius's life, and who would himself live an ascetical life once made bishop of Hippo, was none other than St. Augustine, perhaps the greatest theologian in the history of Christianity. Augustine of Hippo. It would be impossible to do even minimal justice to the writings of Augustine in a short space. Here we will concentrate on a number of theological controversies in which he was deeply, aggressively, and in the eyes of some, heartlessly involved. We will do so because his theological opponents, who usually ended up condemned as heretics, had ideas not dissimilar to a number of heretical and even some orthodox individuals and groups in the Middle Ages, and later during the Reformation. When medieval clerics observed these groups, they imagined them often in the hostile terms conceived by Augustine. In other words, they thought they perceived the reemergence in their own day of the very enemies against whom Augustine had fought centuries earlier. In addition, Augustine established what we might call the authoritative Christian theology of the Jews. Augustine was born in Numidia, a Roman province of North Africa. His mother Monica was baptized, his father was a non-Christian. In his Confessions, the major semi-autobiographical source for much of his life, Augustine describes the classical education he received. A pivotal moment in his religious development occurred when he read Cicero's Hortensius, extant now only in fragments, then a regular part of the school curriculum, which had its intended effect of stimulating his desire for learning. Chronically unhappy, he was easy prey for the Manichaeans, who, like the Gnostics, preached a thoroughgoing dualism of good and evil and a complicated route to redemption. He resisted his mother's deeply heartfelt attempts to have him convert to Catholic Christianity. Reading the Hebrew Bible, he dismissed it as a collection of fables, written in inelegant Latin. While a Manichae, he was made professor of rhetoric in Milan, where he attended the sermons of the redoubtable bishop of Italy's second city, Ambrose, which he found both philosophically substantive and theologically acute. By this time he had become disillusioned with the teachings of the Manichaeans, which he had followed for almost a decade. Also protracted and deep was his desire for women and sex. In accordance with the custom of the era, he had taken a mistress, with whom he fathered a son, Adiodatus, given by God. He presents his final conversion to Christianity as a kind of divinely wrought liberation from sexual desire, but it was more complicated than that. In any case, after a long period of hesitation, he was finally baptized by Ambrose on Easter 387. Not long thereafter, Augustine returned to Africa, while he was traveling through the town of Hippo to found a monastery, for his son had died. Popular acclaim elevated him to the priesthood. The bishop of the city paved the way for Augustine to become his successor, and in 395, Augustine became bishop of Hippo. He would hold that position for the remaining 35 years of his life. It was a life spent pastoring the community and presiding for endless hours over the ecclesiastical court in Hippo. In addition, he wrote voluminously on the doctrinal and disciplinary squabbles that threatened the unity of the church in North Africa, and in his mind, the essence of the Christian gospel of grace. The first of these threats originated during the great persecution by Diocletian. A group of African bishops was convinced that a bishop of Carthage, Caecilian, had been consecrated by three bishops, one of whom, Felix of Opthungi, was considered a traitor for surrendering sacred books over to the Romans. In the eyes of these bishops, called the Donatists, after Donatus, one of their number, this offense was so egregious that it made Caecilian's ordination invalid. He was a traitor, traditor, literally one who had handed over the scriptures, one whose ordination was ruined by collaboration with the diabolical state. By the time Augustine arrived in Hippo, the Donatist church there was larger than the Catholic, and a century-long schism between the two looked as if it might remain permanent. The issue here was not exactly doctrinal. Both, among other things, viewed the Nicene decision as orthodox. What divided the two churches were their views of ecclesiastical purity, the nature of the church, a society of sinners, or of the perfect, the character of the priesthood, and the validity of sacraments administered by lapsed priests and bishops. The schism was complicated by social and ethnic factors as well, as the Catholic Church was associated with empire, power, the city, and the Latin language, while the Donatists were largely rural, of Berber stock and language, and settled farmers. The Donatist view of church was that it should be the pure bride of Christ, without spot or wrinkle, the church of the perfect, the church of whom martyrs would have been proud to have been members. Like Noah's Ark, it contained only a small minority of the pure. Sacraments dispensed by those disgraced and even contaminated by collaboration with empire, or associated with those who were ineffective and even polluting. Augustine's view of church was that it was a mixed body of saints and sinners until it was perfected by God at the end of time. Wheat and tares, the parable, Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 through 30, to which Augustine habitually alluded in the controversy, would not be separated until the end of time. Noah's Ark, its stack of animals, the stench, a symbol of sin that all would have to tolerate. The baptized were made up of the morally mediocre for the most part, fallible sinners whose need for forgiveness was virtually constant, and for whom the forgiving church was established. The Donatists were not persuaded. Eventually, the North African bishops suggested that force be used by the Empire and the Catholic Church to eradicate the Donatists or bring them into conformity with Catholic orthodoxy. Augustine hesitated, but persecution of the Donatists, favored by his North African episcopal colleagues, proved effective in forcing them to embrace, at least nominally, the faith they had once despised. Augustine changed his mind. Now he urged that the Donatists be compelled to enter, as the master instructs his servants in the parable of the banquet in Luke chapter 14, verse 23, the Catholic Church. For this stance, some have harshly and not very convincingly faulted him for fathering the Inquisition. Besides, the Donatists had their own terrorists, called Circumcellions, among the most aggrieved socially of the Donatist Church, who intimidated many, and though Augustine may have exaggerated this, mutilated and killed priests. Be that as it may, force did not wipe out the Donatists. Ironically, both Donatists and Catholics, who accepted the Nicene view that the father and son were of the same nature, would be persecuted by Arian Vandals in the 5th century. The Donatists would disappear from the map of North Africa only in the 7th century, when Muslim Arabs swept through Roman North Africa and captured Carthage in 697. Unlike Donatism, the debate over Pelagianism was doctrinal. Indeed, it touched on an issue that Augustine regarded, to use the modern term, as the very essence of Christianity, namely the way in which sinful humanity is redeemed by the grace of God. What both movements, Donatism and Pelagianism, shared, however, was a belief in the possibility, even the necessity, of personal and ecclesial perfection. Though not perhaps a strict Pelagian himself, more on this question to follow, Pelagius, probably a British ascetic, did teach and write about the themes associated with this eponymous and large movement, the capacity for free choice of good or evil, the reality and nature of the help, grace, given to humanity in moral choice, and the possibility of perfection. By the late 4th century, he found himself in Rome, the leader of many of the groups dedicated to a holy Christian life. Appalled by Augustine's prayer in the Confessions, where Augustine pleads with God to grant him the grace to do what he commands, implying that humans were too damaged by sin to choose the good, Pelagius regarded Augustine's views as implying far too negative a view of human capacity. For Pelagius, the gifts of God given in creation were sufficient for humans to choose the good, the ability to discriminate between good and evil, the instruction of the Scriptures, the examples of Christ and the saints, and the will to do the good. Almost needless to say, this view was based on a far more optimistic theological anthropology than Augustine's. Human beings sin, in Pelagius's view, not because of some inherited fatal flaw, but because they imitate the bad habits of Adam and of their fellow human beings. Essentially, all have the freedom, because of the help of God given in creation, not to choose the bad. Pelagius, in fact, rejected the distinction between the life of religious perfection chosen by a few and the life of sinning and mediocrity preferred by the many. Indeed, he looked forward to the day when all would practice the virtues conventionally associated with the ascetical life. Augustine regarded these views, especially as accentuated or distorted by Pelagius's followers, as a simple betrayal of the Christian message of God's deliverance of sinful humanity through his freely bestowed and unmerited grace. Those who had received grace had been mysteriously predestined by God without regard to merit. Those not so predestined were doomed to perdition. Grace could not simply mean the gifts given in creation, for humanity was far too impaired in the fall to choose the good without grace. By grace, Augustine meant a power from God capable of transforming the soul so that it would so desire and love the good as to choose it spontaneously. Still, even if helped by God's grace, perfection was not a possibility in this life. The Christian life was a constant daily struggle against sin, a pilgrimage toward the ideal of perfection. Augustine charged Pelagius with denying the Christian's need for grace. This is a charge that few historians today would credit. That is what they mean when they say that Pelagius was himself not a strict Pelagian, for he did not deny the need for God's grace. He simply imagined it in terms radically different than Augustine's, terms sometimes called creationist, or given in creation, not to be confused with the modern definition of that view of divine creation. Eventually, the cause of Pelagius was taken up by the talented Bishop Julian of Eclanum, with whom Augustine waged a ferocious literary war in the 420s. Julian was not the only Pelagian sympathizer to argue that Augustine's Manichaean past had disastrously undermined his capacity to appreciate the Christian gospel. A tiger, he taunted Augustine, never changes his stripes. Augustine, despite his baptism, was captive to a view of human nature that was essentially non-Christian, a view of election, predestination, that was deterministic, and of creation that was Gnostic. For roughly a century, the debate raged on, surviving the deaths of its originators. Among those who repudiated the Augustinian view were monks from Gaul, who did not appreciate Augustine's views that their daily quest for perfection was futile, and indeed most of the Gallic Church. An attempt to marry Pelagius's views on human freedom with Augustine's appreciation for the absolute need for God's grace, a sort of compromise between the opposed extreme positions associated with Pelagius and Augustine, was finally achieved at a council in the Gallic town of Orange in 529. In the long run, for good or ill, Augustine's view of depraved human nature and the absolute dependence of humanity on God's healing grace would have a far more profound influence on Western theology. His views of predestination were regarded as authoritative by many, but some who wished to be Augustinian found it awkward to embrace this harsh doctrine. It is, as many later theologians found, virtually impossible to preach the grace of God to a community of Christians whose God had for unknown reasons assigned a majority of them to damnation. Long before Augustine's death, the Visigothic king Alaric, another Arian, would in 410 capture and sack the city of Rome. Pagan critics charged again that disaster had befallen the Romans because of neglect of the gods and the spread of Christianity. Augustine countered with a massive book entitled The City of God, in which he demonstrated that wars, invasion, and adversity long antedated Christianity. He also distinguished two invisible communities, the City of God and the City of the World. Each had its own origin, destiny, and character. The City of God, which Augustine did not simply identify with the Church, aimed for holiness and salvation, the City of the World for mundane achievement, pleasure, power, and wealth. The City of God consisted of those predestined by God for salvation, and those of the City of the World for damnation. However, some in the City of the World were also among the elect, dwelling temporarily in the spiritually foreign, worldly city. Kingdoms and empires came and went. They were far less real, less permanent, and less important than the two cities. They could provide a minimal form of justice and, at their best, peace. The City of God is one of the three or so works in which Augustine expresses his views about a very visible and ancient community in the Roman Empire. Though two major rebellions in Palestine had been brutally put down by the Romans, Jewish communities were tolerated by law and had long been protected by the Romans. An ancient religion, Judaism, had many admirers among the Romans. While Jews were not permitted to rebuild the temple destroyed by the Romans in the first rebellion in 70 CE, a disaster to which the Gospel of Mark alludes, nor to return to Jerusalem, they were permitted to exist, hold property, and perform religious services. On the other hand, it was not easy to secure permission to build new synagogues, nor were Jews allowed to convert or attempt to convert others. Contrary to widespread belief, Judaism in some of the Second Temple period was very much a proselytizing religion, a fact that accounts for why, especially in the Eastern Empire, the numbers of Jews soared to hold political office or to hold baptized slaves. Augustine's views of Jews and Judaism, his doctrine of Jewish witness, might easily be regarded as the authoritative Western view from the time of his death in the 5th century until the Second Vatican Council in the 20th. Early in his writing career, Augustine, following a well-established Christian tradition, identified the biblical characters of Cain and Abel from the book of Genesis as symbols of the Jews and Jesus Christ, respectively. For their guilt in the murder of Christ, the Jews, like Cain, who killed his brother Abel, were exiled from their land, and in exile they would continue to live in sorrow, anxiety, and servitude until the end of time. Bearing the mark of Cain, they were to be permitted to live, though again only in subjugation, by Gentile emperors and kings in whose lands they were dispersed. In Augustine's view, it was thus God's will that Judaism should endure, and Jews not be slain. Biblically, the survival of the Jews and their dispersion were, Augustine argued, mandated by Psalms chapter 59, verse 12. Slay them not, lest at any time they forget your law. Scatter them in your might. The survival of the Jews, as well as their continued practice of Judaism, was intended in several respects to witness to the truth of Christianity. First of all, their condition of dispersion and subjugation served to authenticate the triumph and truth of Christianity and the displacement of the synagogue by the church. Second, by preserving their scriptures, the Jews unintentionally would preserve the prophecies concerning Christ contained within them. In this way, they proved to pagan critics of, or recent converts to Christianity, that the church had not forged those prophecies. Thus, Jews served insensibly as custodians of the books that proved the messiahship of Christ and that contained prophecies of their own blindness and rejection. In short, if Jews had a continuing place in the drama of divine salvation, it was solely as a witness people to vindicate the truth of the new religion. This doctrine of Jewish witness was charged with mixed meanings for Jews, especially since it helped to shape the ways the Jews were treated by Christian leaders and peoples for millennia. On the one hand, no potentate could coerce Jews into ceasing the practice of Judaism, although this proviso was not always observed even by Christian clerics. As we have seen, Augustine did not extend the same tolerance to non-Orthodox Christians, such as the Donatists, against whom he condoned imperial punishment. On the other hand, they were to be permitted to practice Judaism only as a service of witness to the church. According to historian Jeremy Cohen, the invocation of Psalm 59 with its mandate not to slay them served as a prophetic policy statement that not only prevented their liquidation but also guaranteed them religious freedom. Yet the second half of the psalm, scatter them in your might, makes their dispersion a matter of divine will and human obligation. Less ambiguously, it was simply assumed, according to the eschatological scenario laid out by Augustine, that the Jews would convert to Christianity at the end of time. Moreover, the doctrine underscored the sole responsibility of the Jews for the death of Christ, emphasized their supposed stubbornness and blindness in refusing to acknowledge Christ as Messiah, and viewed Jewish religion and the synagogue as essentially moribund. The danger in this view of Jews and Judaism when put into practice, aside from the obvious psychological, social, political, and economic disabilities it could inflict, is that the religious and cultural presuppositions favoring and even demanding Jewish survival could change, wither away, or disappear altogether in different historical circumstances. A second, although less serious danger, yet not unknown in the Middle Ages or in the modern period, is that the principle could be ignored, even among those for whom it remained theoretically authoritative. Thus, the Augustinian doctrine was unable to prevent, in Christian societies, instances of forced conversion, expulsion, and in the Crusades and Black Death, mass murder. Ultimately, the tension between the two halves of Augustine's teaching proved, in the Middle Ages, difficult, and then, in the modern period, tragically impossible to maintain. In some ways, the end of Augustine's life symbolizes the end of the ancient Roman order and the dawn of a new biblical culture. That is not untrue, but much more needs to be said about this question, as we will hear. The end of ancient Christianity. Scholars debate the question of when the Christian Middle Ages began because so very much rides on historians' responses to it. namely what distinguishes this period from the centuries that came before and the scores of decades that follow it. What are this religious tradition's unique characteristics, institutions, figures, thoughts, relationship to its past, events, practices, cultural realities, geographical reach, relations to outsiders, forms of religious life, dissent, demographic challenges, or catastrophes? And above all, how do these realities change over time within an established chronological framework? Historians can hardly avoid this latter diachronic treatment of materials. Still, few approaches are so pure, and a treatment like this one that attempts to trace phenomena over time will also have its synchronic layers, dimensions, and moments. That is, it will step back at times to take a temporarily static view of a complex religio-cultural reality of particular importance. Perhaps the most stimulating and persuasive examination of these questions is a book authored by Robert Marcus, entitled The End of Ancient Christianity. Examining the period circa 400 to 600 CE, when Christianization on a large scale began, until the empire dissolved into a crazy quilt of barbarian kingdoms, Marcus argues that Western Christendom was in these centuries undergoing a period of desecularization. Secular government, education, and culture were all collapsing. Western Europe, he argues, was being drained of the secular being defined as that domain of life not considered to be of direct religious significance. As the realm allowed to the secular shrank, the area occupied by the sacred grew. The process Marcus describes is rather like the reverse of the modern process of secularization, where areas of life, thought, and activity are withdrawn from religious or ecclesiastical influence. What were the signs of this process of desecularization in late ancient and early medieval Christianity? To start with, as the age of the martyrs receded into the distant past, Christians filled their calendar, sacralized it, with feast days of the martyrs. Relics, or pieces of the past, bridged the time between past and present. Time had been made holy, and something similar happened with space. In the 5th century, the Western emperors left Rome for Ravenna, and the papacy expanded in an area removed from the political and civic center of pagan Rome. Bishops in Rome and other metropolises also began to take over municipal authority and assume civic responsibility for their episcopal cities. Christian churches multiplied in the towns. Baths, theaters, and circuses disappeared. There was now such a thing as Christian topography. Culturally speaking, secular and pagan traditions had disappeared by the 580s, replaced by a wholly biblical language and culture. Particularly significant was the way in which ascetic norms and attitudes entered the cultural bloodstream of the West, how monastic ideals came to be embraced by those outside the walls of the proliferating monasteries. The values of the desert came to be established in the city, as the distinction between those two geographical and cultural realms began to blur. Present in the city, monks influenced and inspired laymen and women. Bishops, many of them once monks, encouraged monastic reading practices in their dioceses, such as reading and meditating on the Bible. A way of life based on withdrawal moved to the city. The periphery and center collapsed into one. Ascetical ideals came increasingly to be appropriated not only by lay Christians, but also by priests and bishops. The walls that separated the lives of monks, the secular clergy, and the laity slowly crumbled. By the late 6th century, a new age had dawned. 2. Early Medieval Christianity, circa 600 to 1050. 2. Beginnings, the conversion of the West and the emergence of Celtic Christianity. By the time of Augustine, the Roman Empire had famously been in decline for some 3 centuries. It would not be far wrong to say that the empire had achieved the height of its prosperity, socio-economic well-being, and military power in the mid-second century. By the end of the 4th century, a new element would be introduced, that would upset the empire's already delicate, precarious politico-economic ecology, the Germans. Sometimes called the Germanic peoples, sometimes the barbarian invaders, it is best to recognize that they were German-speaking, not that they possessed a kind of ethnic purity or a set of shared social and political structures. The great Roman historian Edward Gibbon could speak glibly about the ferocious temper of the conquerors. The truth is that the Germans had been pushed from their homelands near the Baltic Sea to the border of the Roman Empire by the truly menacing Huns, a nomadic tribe that had been routed by the Chinese and, in the wake of defeat, pressed westward. By circa 375, the Huns had defeated the Ostrogoths, whom they would then dominate for nearly a century. The Germans, by contrast, were, by and large, not belligerent. Rather, they were attracted by qualities of Roman life, including the relative ease of agricultural production and trade. Very recent archaeological evidence suggests that the border between the Germans and Romans was somewhat porous, and some intermarriage occurred. In effect, the Germans were looking for a suitable homeland, free from the terror of domination by the Huns. In fact, one of the Germanic groups, the Visigoths, hoping to escape Hunnish control, applied to the Romans for permission to cross the Danube and enter imperial territory, a request that was granted. Nonetheless, conflicts sometimes broke out. One, the Battle of Adrianople, has been vested with special significance. It was there that the Emperor Valens lost his life and his army to the very Visigoths his predecessors had allowed into Western Imperial territory. With the benefit of hindsight, we may say that this was the battle that began the wandering of the German peoples, or, if you like, the Germanic or barbarian invasions into the Western Empire. Almost exactly a century later, in 476, the child emperor Romulus Augustulus would be deposed. The West would soon be invaded, occupied, and ruled by new confederacies of Germans, Visigoths, Ostrogoths, Vandals, Lombards, Franks, Angles, Saxons, Jutes, and others. Now political and religious forces would pull the old empire into three parts. In the West, the large Roman population would be ruled by more powerful German overlords. Roman emperors would continue to preside over the Eastern or Byzantine Empire in Constantinople. Finally, in the 7th century, Muslim expansion would result in the taking of much of the old empire, including the Near East, North Africa, and Spain. In the eyes of some scholars, like the great Belgian historian Henri Piren, the Muslim expansion marks the beginning of the history of the European West. Without Muhammad, Piren argued, there would never have been a European Christian emperor. Without the effect of the Islamic expansion, which was to cut off Western ties of trade to the East, the West would never have emerged with its own unique identity. The Piren thesis, as it has been called, has been much debated. However one comes down on that thesis, it is clear that by 750 CE or so, a new political equilibrium had been reached. The old empire now lay divided into the Germanic and Roman West, the Byzantine East, and the Arab Empire. The East had a common language, Greek, and was religiously orthodox. The Arab Empire also had a common language, Arabic, and a common religion, Islam. The West had no common religion or language. Those Germanic invaders who were baptized were Aryan. Those not baptized worshipped their own gods. By the time of the deposition of the last Roman emperor in the West, not only did it seem as if linguistic unity would be impossible ever to achieve, but also religious unity seemed a very remote possibility indeed. In addition to hosting worshippers of the ancient Roman gods, Europe, no longer an empire but an aggregation of smaller kingdoms, now was home to practitioners of Germanic religions, to Catholic Christians, and to baptized Germans who practiced a form of Christianity that was regarded as dangerously heretical by Catholic Christians. How, if at all, would these various kingdoms reemerge into an empire, united, religiously speaking, by Roman Catholicism? Born of a Cappadocian Christian family that had been captured by the Goths, Ulfilas was fluent not only in Greek and Latin, but in Gothic as well. Consecrated bishop around 340 by Eusebius of Nicomedia, An Arian, who was then Bishop of Constantinople, Ulfilas laid the foundation by which the Goths later became Arian Christians, and Gothic became a written language based on Greek. Aside from preaching an Arian creed, he translated the New Testament into Gothic. In this way, his Arian style of Christianity passed from the Goths to other Germanic tribes, and moved back into the Western Empire when the Germanic tribes crossed the old frontiers, established kingdoms, and began to settle. The Western Goths, or Visigoths, terrified of the Huns, who were migrating westward from Central Asia, already occupied the banks of the Danube late in the 3rd century when Dacia was given to them by the Romans. As noted in 378, in a conflict over land and food, they defeated the Romans at Adrianople. Emperor Theodosius I thereafter recognized them as Roman allies and confirmed them in their possessions along the Danube. By the end of the century, however, they were raiding again and ravaged the Balkans. As the Visigoths attempted to secure better land, agreements were made with the Romans and then breached. Hostilities over food provisions and other terms caused King Alaric to move into Italy, where he famously sacked Rome in 410. From Rome, the Visigoths continued south, carrying with them as a hostage the emperor's sister, Galla Placidia. They moved north again through Italy and southern Gaul after an unsuccessful attempt to invade Africa. In 418, the Visigoths defeated the Vandals in Spain. In return, they were allowed to settle in southwestern Gaul, Aquitania, where they had their capital in Toulouse. They were now recognized again as allies of the Roman Empire, in which capacity they crossed the Pyrenees in response to a call for military aid. Over the course of the 5th century, they expanded their hold in Gaul, and in the 5th century joined with the Franks to defeat Attila and the Huns. Between 453 and 466, the Visigoths occupied most of Roman Spain. In the 6th century, some Visigothic leaders began to see advantages to closer cooperation with the Spanish ecclesiastical hierarchy. Meanwhile, a fusion of the Germanic and Roman populations gradually proceeded. A new Gallo-Roman culture emerged, based on Roman law and education, Catholic Christianity, and Germanic politics and military prowess. Finally, the Visigothic king Recared I formally converted to Catholicism in 587. In 589, the Third Council of Toledo declared Catholicism to be the religion of the Visigoths. Nearly all vestiges of Arianism rapidly disappeared in Spain. The same sort of pattern occurred with the enemies of the Visigoths, the Vandals. The Vandals were Germanic peoples that originated in Scandinavia or the Baltic region. As a result of pressure from the Huns, they moved westward and crossed the Rhine frontier in 406, moved through Gaul, and in 409 across the Pyrenees into Spain. They may have converted to Arian Christianity before they crossed the frontier. As they continued to move westward, they for a time settled in Spain, but the Visigoths, now the allies of Rome, routed them from the Iberian Peninsula. They crossed the Straits of Gibraltar in 429, and occupied with little difficulty northern Africa, along with the islands of the western Mediterranean. During the Vandals' long siege of Hippo, Augustine died in his episcopal city in 430. The Vandals, Arian Christians, permitted only the private observation of Catholicism. They occasionally persecuted Catholic Christianity, which consequently lost a number of churches. Some Catholic bishops were also sent into exile. In the early 6th century, the Emperor Justinian's army, then attempting to reunite the eastern and western halves of the empire, attacked the Vandals. The Emperor justified his attack in part as an attempt to eradicate the Arian heresy. By 533, the Vandal army was defeated. Justinian I restored Catholicism, returned its exiled bishops, and restored property taken by the Vandals. All remains of Vandal culture, including their religious culture, disappeared within a short period of time. It was a Germanic king, Odoacer, who deposed the Western Emperor Romulus Augustulus in 476. After deposing Romulus, Odoacer simply sent notice to the Eastern Emperor that he was now ruling Italy in his name. The Ostrogothic king, Theodoric, invaded Italy at the request of the Eastern Emperor in 483, murdered Odoacer, then established the Kingdom of Italy, which included not only the peninsula but also Provence and the Dalmatian coast. He established his capital at Ravenna, where he erected a basilica to Christ the Savior. Theodoric proved to be among the more enlightened of the barbarian kings. Unlike some of the Western Gothic kings, he was tolerant of Roman Catholicism and had close working relations with the senatorial aristocracy of Old Rome. He also maintained good relations with the Byzantine Empire. He deeply respected much of the Roman administrative personnel and administrative system, including two of its leading lights, Boethius, whom he eventually turned against, and Cassiodorus. Born into a prominent Roman family, Boethius was early taught two traditions, Greek philosophy and Catholic Christianity. Both would inform his impressive literary legacy. Indeed, like the early Christian apologists, he used Greek philosophy to present Orthodox Catholicism as rational and true. In addition to his intellectual accomplishments, he had an extraordinarily distinguished political career. In 510, he was made consul and then became a senator. Later, King Theodoric established Boethius's sons as consuls in Rome, and then made Boethius one of the highest administrative officers in Italy, the Master of Offices, Magister Officiorum. Despite this auspicious beginning, Boethius was eventually implicated in a charge of treason against Theodoric. It is possible that his defense of Orthodox Catholicism hurt him in the court of an Arian king. In any case, he was arrested in 523, incarcerated for an unusually long time in Pavia, and then executed circa 524. While in prison, he wrote his final and most famous work, The Consolation of Philosophy, a meditation on innocent suffering and an attempt to reconcile human freedom with divine sovereignty. Boethius famously abstained in his short book from making any reference to the Christian scriptures or creeds. Instead, the Consolation is a work of a philosopher, attempting rationally to comprehend the problem of evil and the difficulty of reconciling human free will and divine foreknowledge. Despite the absence of Christian vocabulary, the work was considered so important from the Carolingian era through the late Middle Ages that nearly every library of any significance, all of them Christian, had a copy made of it. Consequently, the manuscript tradition is unusually rich. One of the first literary works to be translated into the emerging European vernaculars, its influence has led some historians to link Boethius together with Augustine, Ambrose, and Jerome as one of the founders of the Middle Ages. Yet it was not just the Consolation that earned Boethius that honor. Sometimes called the first scholastic in Europe, Boethius established the essentials of the medieval educational program. He also commented on Aristotle and other ancient Greek authorities. In fact, Boethius, in effect, invented what he called the quadrivium, the four mathematical disciplines of arithmetic, geometry, music, and astronomy. The quadrivium would be standard in educational institutions for centuries. Boethius's credentials for being the first scholastic are that he wrote several important logical treatises and translated Aristotle's Prior Analytics and Posterior Analytics. These translations then went on to form the fundamental foundation of Aristotelian logic in the high medieval scholastic period. Like Boethius, Cassiodorus held a number of important positions at the Italian court in the 6th century. Born to an Italian senatorial family, he received an excellent education in the liberal arts and was brought to the Ostrogothic court as the official composer of letters and other documents for the king. Around 540, he took a turn away from politics and went to Constantinople to study theology. 14 years later, he returned to Vivarium, a monastery in Squillace, his birthplace, that he founded before his departure for Constantinople. It seems that he imagined it as a citadel for instruction in non-secular subjects, like theology, and as a scriptorium for reproducing important books. It was at Vivarium that he produced some of his most influential theological works. Perhaps the most important of these is his Institutions, which he completed circa 562, designed as an introduction to the educational program for monks at Vivarium, the work is divided into two large books. In the first book, Cassiodorus documents the books at the library at Vivarium, instructs his readers on which heresies are to be shunned, and teaches the monks how to copy manuscripts. In the second book, Cassiodorus discusses the seven liberal arts, a treatment that was to be reproduced often, and that influenced writers deeply in the Carolingian period. Cassiodorus's death also marked the demise of Vivarium. However, his works survived and were deeply influential. In addition, many of the books he had collected were copied by his monks and from there circulated widely through medieval cloisters. Cassiodorus's most important work would coincide with catastrophic war on the Italian peninsula. In 527, Justinian became emperor. Under the command of Belisarius, Justinian launched his Italian campaign, part of his ambitious expedition to reunite the empire. The imperial forces conquered Rome in 536 and took the Gothic capital, Ravenna, 4 years later. Yet the Goths were remarkably resilient. One Ostrogothic king recovered almost all of Italy, and it took two more campaigns from Justinian's forces to subdue Gothic resistance, which ended only circa 562. The long years of warfare were disastrous for Italy, leaving a political vacuum to be filled by the bellicose Lombards, some of whom were probably converted to Arianism in the 6th century. Mentioned already by the Roman historian Tacitus, the Lombards initially occupied territory along the Elbe. During Justinian's reconquest of Italy, Lombards served as mercenaries in the Eastern Roman army. In 568, they invaded Italy. By 572, they had subdued the entire Po Valley. Soon, most of the peninsula, excepting Venice, Ravenna, Rome, and other coastal areas, fell under Lombard domination. For a time, it seemed as if all Italy might fall. But in 774, the Lombards faced and were destroyed by the most powerful of the Germanic kingdoms, that of the Franks. The conversion of the Franks. When they crossed the frontiers of the empire, the Franks had not yet been baptized as Christians. Early in the 5th century, they dwelt in the Lower Rhine, partly in Gaul and partly in Germany. The Emperor Julian the Apostate made them allies of the empire, in exchange for which they were expected to defend the region of the frontier in which they dwelt. That region, even in the 3rd century, was called Francia, land of the Franks. Once recognized by the emperor, many Franks had good relations with the Romans, and some even held high office. During the 4th and 5th centuries, the Frankish people began to mingle, and then emerge into two distinct groups, one Western and one Eastern. The integration of the Western group occurred under the leadership of a family later known as the Merovingians. An exceptionally important Merovingian king for the future of Western Christianity was named Clovis I, the monarch who united all Franks, sometimes by annihilating close-blood relatives. Clovis's military conquests, once extended by his sons, brought all of Gaul under Frankish overlordship. At the time of their incursion to the west, the Frankish invaders were not Arians. In the end, it was Clovis's landlust and hunger for power that led him to Catholic Christianity. Most of central and southern Gaul was Catholic, while its rulers were Visigoths and therefore Arian. For political and military reasons, it was useful for Clovis to have experience of, and if possible, the appreciation of, Catholic bishops. Even while conquering, he warned his warriors not to loot churches and territories just subjugated. In a story that seems to repeat itself in early medieval history, it so happened that Clovis's wife, Clotilda, was a Catholic. The source of this story, the chronicler Gregory of Tours, reports that Clotilda had unsuccessfully attempted to convert her husband. Since early medieval Christians were unabashedly instrumental in their view of religion, Clotilda and her fellow Catholics tried to convert Clovis by persuading him that he ought, for reasons of military success, worship the Christian God. Clovis pondered the argument. In a difficult battle with another Germanic tribe, his own gods derelict, he made a famous covenant with Clotilda's God. Jesus Christ, who Clotilda says is the Son of the living God, you are said to give aid to those who are laboring and to bestow a victory on those hoping in you. Full of devotion, I beg the glory of your help, so that if you will grant me victory over these enemies, and if I may have experienced that power which the people dedicated to your name say that they have experienced from you, then I will believe in you, and I will be baptized in your name. I have called upon my own gods, but as I learn they are far away from my aid. Hence I believe that they are endowed with no power, since they do not come to the assistance of those who obey them. I call on you. I want to believe in you, if only I am snatched from my enemies. Because Clovis's warriors had not yet heard of Jesus Christ, nor agreed to convert, Clovis was catechized secretly by Remigius, Bishop of Reims. Finally, at a gathering of his warriors, Clovis persuaded them to convert. More than 3,000 are said to have done so between 496 and 506. This was a momentous development. The man who now controlled most of central and northern Gaul, and who ruled the only stable kingdom in the center of Western Europe, had linked destinies with Catholic Christianity. A single, military-powerful kingdom now had a Catholic ruler, soon recognized by the Eastern emperors as consul. In their eyes, the kingdom of the Franks, Regnum Francorum, continued the presence of Roman authority and tradition. This assessment was essentially a welcome development from the perspective of Frankish bishops, even though Frankish kings later interfered routinely in ecclesiastical affairs. They bestowed episcopal sees on friends and family, and took ecclesiastical property as it suited them. Nonetheless, the Frankish leadership would be a champion and ally without whom the Catholic Church could not have survived the political and military calamities of the 6th and 7th centuries. The Church was made even more content with them, as the Franks absorbed elements of classical culture, not least of all Latin, which eventually evolved into contemporary French. They intermarried with the Romans, whose territories they conquered. Thus was created a Gallo-Roman culture based religiously on Catholicism and linguistically on Latin. Frankish kings championed the growth of the monastic movement and of missionizing. Ironically, this once pagan federation of tribes helped spread Christianity by weakening or driving out extant pagan groups. The episcopal support that Clovis had sought gave the Franks some advantage in conflicts with the Visigothic and Burgundian kingdoms, which would be incorporated into the larger Frankish kingdom. Male and female ascetics in Gaul, the double monastery. The wife of Clovis II was a woman from the lower orders of Saxon society in Britain. It was customary for men from the Merovingian line to ignore matters of social class when selecting wives. Named Baltild, she was both politically astute and pious. A friend of powerful churchmen, she was also a sponsor and promoter of the monastic order. Around 660, she founded the important abbey of Corbi. Yet the monastic project dearest to her heart was Shell, an abbey of nuns established on a royal villa built by Clotilda, the wife of Clovis I. After expanding the villa...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.